And in this paper, we will investigate using a model to which extent changes in the income distribution in Germany with, compared to the rest of the euro area and the rest of the world might be able to explain the development of the surplus. And our motivation, that's the way this works. Okay, and our motivation for this angle comes from the fact that as you can see here in the black dotted line, the increase, and you can see there the German export surplus as a percentage of GDP, and you can see that this has been associated with an increase in the income share of the top 10% of households. That's the black solid line there. Whereas in the rest of the euro area, the top 10% income share has been much more flat. There's also no clear trend in the export surplus of the rest of the euro area. That's the red dotted line. Furthermore, the other motivation comes from the fact that over the same period, this increase in income inequality in Germany due to the size of the economy has been reflected in an increase in the share of the top 10% of households at the euro area level, whereas over the same period, estimates of the natural rate of interest, so the interest rate associated with the with the situation of macroeconomic balance where the output gap is closed and inflation is as its target, has also declined. And what we do is we connect these trends in an open economy model of Germany, abbreviated here throughout as DE, the rest of the euro area, REA, and the rest of the world. And in this model, there are rich households representing the top 10% of the distribution who have capitalist spirit type preferences over their wealth. So they derive intrinsic utility from their wealth. And this feature is interesting because it allows the model to match the empirically observed high marginal propensity to save of rich households out of changes in their permanent income, something with which a standard infinite horizon model could not generate. And at the macroeconomic level, this feature then means that an income increase of rich households at the expense of non-rich households will raise saving at the macro level and will thus be reflected in net exports and at the euro area level at a lower real interest rate because the central bank, which wants to maintain its inflation target, then lowers the interest rate to stabilize aggregate demand. And when we feed this, we feed the empirically observed increase in income inequality into the model, we can simulate an increase in net exports by about 3% of GDP by 2016, and a decline in the real interest rate in the euro area by about 1 percentage point. This paper builds on a closed economy model of myself, which links the decline in the US natural interest rate, the increase in household indebtedness and house prices to the increase in income inequality there. There are other contributions who have emphasized a link between the natural interest rate and income inequality using CSP, like Straub and Mian et al. There is a literature on the origin of the German export surplus and there are two papers which emphasize the role of the distribution of income, but these papers do not really attempt to quantitatively link the long-run trends of income inequality in the export surplus. And there's also no consideration of wage dispersion in these papers. One paper, this first one there, Grüning, is a small open economy, a very stylized small open economy model. Where rich households have CSP, and the second one is an estimated model of Germany, the rest of the euro, and the rest of the world, which investigates the role of transitory wage push shocks. But they only find a marginal contribution to net exports, but then they, inter alia, also simply abstract by assumption by the way they treat the data on which they estimate the model from movements in the labor share. Then there's literature looking at the effect of faster aging in Germany versus the rest of the world, Schön and Stähler and Hubert and Stähler, using an open economy overlapping generation model. And they find an average increase over 2000 to 2018 of net exports of 1 to 3% of GDP, but it's a very transitory effect, and especially once China's demographic change is taken into account. And then there has been a literature looking at the effect of the German labor market and tax reforms, and those have mostly found small effects. One paper which is interesting from the point of view of what we find, Kolmar et al., they estimate a DSGE model of Germany, the rest of the euro area, and the rest of the world, and they are in that model. The main driver of the export surplus is a so-called private saving shock, which is simply an exogenous increase in household savings. And this is, in a sense, consistent with our simulation, which generates this higher household saving by the rich endogenously as a result of rising inequality. And interestingly, our simulated increase is similar to their savings shock contribution, both in magnitude and time profile. So let me dive a bit into the model. So I already said this model consists of rich households representing the top 10% of the population. They are infinitely lived and they earn labor and profit income and pay lump sum taxes. They're the sole owners of firms and they invest in domestic assets, rest of the euro area government bonds and rest of the world government bonds. We allow rich households from all regions to invest in government bonds of all other regions, and the results are also robust to allowing for physical capital. You see here like the DE subscript, but really these assumptions which I list here apply to all the three regions. Yes, and then these households derive utility. No, how do I get back? Okay, well, thank you. Yes, so these households derive utility from consumption and labor, and then in the presence of these capitalist spirit preferences, they also derive utility from their asset holdings, which allows to match the high marginal propensity to save out of permanent income increases which rich households appear to have. And the form of the utility function is quite standard in the sense that it's all separable utility, except that it has a sort of constant relative risk aversion form. I mean, the preferences over consumption and these wealth components. And it's separable except that, basically German and rest of the euro area assets are treated as perfect substitutes here. And then there are separate preferences over the rest of the world assets. We will consider below a variant of the model without no CSP in some of the simulations. And regarding wage setting, we assume that there are household unions which set wages in a monopolistically competitive labor market subject to normal rigidities, and we will make an analogous assumption for non-rich households. Non-rich households are also infinitely lived. They earn only wage income and borrow from rich households via financial intermediaries and an interest rate, RL, and that interest rate is assumed to be positively related to their debt-to-income ratio due to a simple ad hoc financial intermediation cost, which may capture default risk or monitoring costs, things like that. And they derive utility from consumption and disutility from labor. There are four layers of firms in this economy. This first layer actually comes from the fact that we want to allow for wage dispersion in this model. So they are called here labor assemblers, and they combine labor of rich and non-rich households to produce homogeneous labor input in an additive production function, and ZR and ZN, these are the labor productivities of rich and non-rich households, and we will later use mean preserving spread essentially in these labor productivities to capture changes in the labor income distribution, so in wage dispersion. Then we have intermediate goods firms who produce domestic output varieties using the homogeneous labor input. And they operate under monopolistic competition and are subject to nominal rigidities, which gives rise to a standard New Keynesian Phillips curve. And we will use changes in their market power, so in their desired price markup, to replicate the decline, observed decline in the empirical labor share. And then there are goods assemblers who produce the output good from these varieties and sell them at a price PH. And some of these goods are sold at home and some of them are sold abroad, and their price on the foreign market is simply calculated by applying the exchange rate to the domestic price. So we assume here producer currency pricing. And then there are final goods firms which produce final consumption good by combining domestically and foreign produced goods, and this gives rise to international trade. The government consists first of all of a central bank, and the central bank in the euro area is one central bank for the euro area, because Germany and the rest of the euro area are in a currency union. And then there is one central bank for the rest of the world. And we assume here, in the results I'm showing, that the central banks pursue a perfect inflation target for simplicity. But if we would assume a Taylor-type interest feedback rule instead, that does not affect the results really, especially not those which I will show later in the when I simulate the historical increase in inequality in the model. And then we have a fiscal authority which simply holds the government debt to government debt and government demand to GDP ratios constant and sets the share of non-rich households in the total tax burden to equal to their income share. Yes, let's turn to the calibration of the model and dwell a bit on the calibration of the capitalist spirit preferences. So the first target, so we calibrate these preferences by matching two empirical targets. And the first target are estimates of the ratio between the gross nominal interest rate and the gross nominal individual discount rate, where there are also some estimates for rich households. And the reason we use that as a target is that this is a feature of the model with capitalist spirit preferences that that indeed the interest rate can be different from the degree of impatience of the household in the steady state. And this, loosely speaking, pins down the utility weight on wealth. And then the second target looks more directly at rich household saving behavior, namely we target an estimate of the marginal propensity to consume out of wealth of the top 10% of households, where we draw on estimates of Gabartini et al. For Germany at an average of estimates for France, Belgium, Spain, and Italy by Gabartini et al. And Arundel et al. And then for the rest of, in principle, we would prefer to target an estimate of the marginal propensity to save out of permanent income changes, as has been done in previous literature focused on the US, but we are not aware of, let's say, an estimate of that object for these countries. And then for the US, then for the rest of the world, we use, we rely on an estimate of the marginal propensity to save of out of a permanent income increase of rich households. And most other parameters are set such that the steady state of the model matches empirical target values, like rate ratio type targets, most of the time. And then there are some parameters which affect only the dynamics of the model, like nominal rigidities, and these are calibrated based on the literature and empirical evidence. Yeah, and now I'm going to show you the effect of a permanent increase in wage dispersion, and these are the results for the German economy. And this increase in wage dispersion is calibrated such that it reduces the share of non-rich households in the medium run by about 1 percentage point, so the share in national income of the bottom 90%. And the red solid line here is the effect of an increase in the model without capital spirit type preferences, so no CSP. And what we see is that in this model, we get the results we would, in a sense, expect in an infinite horizon model, in the sense that consumption of rich households jumps up to its new steady state level. So these households behave as permanent income consumers and raise their consumption by the increase in their permanent income, and then just leave it there. And the non-rich households also reduce their consumption approximately by the amount of their permanent income decline. And so total consumption doesn't really move much, and there's no movement really in the net export to GDP ratio. By contrast, with CSP, that's the red dotted line, there we see that consumption increases much less. So there is, and while consumption of the non-rich declines still by a similar amount, so there is an increase in saving at the national level, and this is reflected in a persistent increase in the net export to GDP ratio. And to keep things a bit intuitive, I mean, this flow chart kind of summarizes the transmission. I should mention that, I mean, I've shown here an increase in wage dispersion, the results for an increase in wage dispersion, but in the medium to long run, the effects of an increase in the price markup are qualitatively and quantitatively very similar, as long as the increase in the markup is also calibrated such that the income share of the rich households increases by 1% of national income. So what I already said, we have an increase in the saving of the top 10%, while the bottom 90% reduce their consumption, and then the result of all of that is that DE domestic demand and imports decline, and this already has a direct effect on net exports. And then there are a couple of indirect effects. So, for instance, there is a decline in employment temporarily, which lowers the real wage and inflation. This has an effect at the euro area level on the policy interest rate, which stimulates also a bit rest of the euro area domestic demand, inflation and the real wage there, and all of this works to contribute to the increase in DE net exports. Let me turn to the main result of the paper in terms of the quantitative contribution. We will now simulate the historically observed inequality increase. And in the first simulation, we will simulate only the increase in German inequality using these two shocks. Using these two shocks, we use the markup shock of these firms, we calibrate that to match the trend of the German labor share. And there are already a couple of papers who have done this for the US case, also informed the price markup shock in this way, if you like. We set the wage inequality shock, so the shock which raises the relative labor productivity of these rich households, to match the empirical decline of the top 10% national income share, which occurs on top of the decline, which is already replicated by the price markup increase. And then we perform a second simulation, which makes the same assumptions as the first one, but on top of that, adds a series of rest of the world price markup shock to match the path of the bottom 90% national income share there. We assume that households expect these shocks to be permanent once they appear, because they are informed to match data trends. And then we repeat those two simulations for an alternative parameterization of the German wage inequality shock, which is in a sense more direct because what we do there is we equate the shock to the path of an estimate of the labor income share of the top 10% of households in total labor income from the German socioeconomic panel. And this is the result. So you can see by assumption, the model matches the German labor share. And it tracks, so the red here you can't see it because all lines are on top of each other, but here like the red line is the data. This is the German non-rich national income share. And the simulations sort of track that as well. If not directly, still, it follows it, let's say. And in the baseline setup for the German wage inequality shock, we activate the wage inequality shock here around 2010, when the German labor share does no longer decline, but the national income share of the non-rich still declines. And what we can see then is that we can generate an increase in the German net export surplus of about 3 percentage points, whereas in the data over this period it's about 6. That's at least a substantial contribution. This increase in the export surplus is sort of roughly equally split between export with and the net exports with respect to the rest of the euro area and the rest of the world. We also find an increase in the German debt to in the debt to income ratio of the non-rich, which also is something we observe also in the data, and the simulation is able to match part of that. Especially once we take into account the inequality increase in the rest of the world. The simulation also produces a decline in the natural interest rate of about 1 percentage point. That brings me to the end of the presentation. So we investigate in this paper the potential effect of rising income inequality on the German export surplus in an open economy model with rich households representing the top 10% of the population and non-rich households. And a crucial feature here is that rich households derive utility from their wealth and therefore save part of a permanent income increase. And when we feed the observed increase in German inequality over the 1992 to 2016 period into the model, we can generate an increase of net exports of about 3% of GDP by the end of the simulation period and a decline in the euro area interest rate, real interest rate, by about 1 percentage point. And I thank you for your attention.